Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. India has raised security concerns with Pakistan over the Kartarpur corridor. The Kartarpur corridor is all set to be inaugurated this weekend, just before the 550th birth anniversary of Guru Nanak. The establishment of this corridor was a long-standing demand of Sikh pilgrims as they consider Gurudwara Darbar Sahib, which is located in the Kartarpur district of Pakistan, to be extremely sacred as it is the final resting place of Guru Nanak. So, in order to fulfill this long-standing demand of Sikh pilgrims, India and Pakistan signed an agreement in 2018 and they undertook a major soft power initiative in order to improve cultural relations and people-to-people relations between the two sides. So, this corridor will connect Dera Baba Nanak Sahib in the Gurdaspur district of India with Gurdwara Darbar Sahib in the Kartarpur district of Pakistan, and it will provide for visa-free travel for Sikh pilgrims. But just days before its inauguration, India has raised security concerns because it believes that the Pakistani security establishment sees a strategic purpose and a dual purpose in the Kartarpur corridor project. The Indian security agencies have enough reasons to believe that the Pakistani army and the ISI might try to use the corridor in order to revive the dormant Khalistan movement. The Indian security agencies have sufficient reasons to draw this conclusion by looking at the enthusiasm that Pakistan has shown in establishing this project. Because in the past, it has always been India which has taken the lead in establishing such peace initiatives and soft power initiatives in order to normalize the relationship. Whenever India has tried to take up such initiatives in the past, Pakistan has never shown enough interest. It has even tried to derail such projects. It has even cancelled and pulled out of such initiatives even at the slightest hint of tensions in the relationship. This has been the consistent behavior of Pakistan all along. But now, the Indian security agencies have been noticing an inconsistent behavior on the part of Pakistan. Pakistan has not only shown a lot of interest and enthusiasm in the establishment of the project, but it has also not pulled out of the project despite the persistence of a number of tensions in the bilateral relationship. 2019 has been a very tense year for both India and Pakistan. First, we had the Pulwama terror attacks. Then we had the Balakot airstrikes, and then we had the revocation of special status of Jammu and Kashmir under Article 370. Despite these hardline policies of India, Pakistan has persisted with the project and it has shown a lot of enthusiasm in the completion of the project. Along with this, the Pakistani government has released a promotional video just days before the inauguration, which contains images of a number of Khalistan terrorists, including Jarnail Singh Bindranwale. It was under his leadership that the sacred Golden Temple had been turned into a hub of terrorism in the 1980s. This pushed the then Indira Gandhi government to launch Operation Blue Star in 1984 in order to flush out the terrorists who were holed up inside the Golden Temple. Indian security agencies have also noticed that the promotional video contains posters related to Referendum 2020. Referendum 2020 refers to a call given by a few radical separatist elements amongst the Sikh diaspora who have the support of the ISI for the establishment of Khalistan by holding a referendum in 2020. So these developments have given enough reason for the Indian security agencies to believe that Pakistan might try to use the Kartarpur corridor for a strategic purpose and a dual purpose. India believes that Pakistan might try to revive Pakistan-based terror outfits such as Babbar Khalsa and Khalistan Liberation Force by establishing contact with the Indian pilgrims who will be visiting Kartarpur. Indian security agencies have also been concerned with a possible security threat for Indian dignitaries such as former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and the Chief Minister of Punjab, Captain Amrinder Singh, who will be taking part in the inauguration ceremony this weekend. But despite these security concerns, India is willing to go ahead with the project by keeping in mind the religious and cultural interests of the Sikh community. Next, we have a related article on page number 13. Former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh has said that the Kartarpur corridor could serve as a model for conflict resolution. Manmohan Singh has said that the teachings of Guru Nanak is based on the philosophy of peace, religious tolerance and oneness of God. According to him, the establishment of the Kartarpur corridor will help in promoting the teachings and messages of Guru Nanak, which could help in ending the sectarian violence, religious conflicts, terrorism, drug trafficking and drug abuse, which had ravaged and destroyed the state of Punjab in the 1980s. This message of former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh applies not just for the Khalistan movement, but it also applies for the conflict between India and Pakistan. So the Kartarpur corridor is a classic example for the role of soft power diplomacy that is based on cultural relations and people-to-people relations in bringing an end to conflicts. In fact, Prime Minister Imran Khan has even equated the inauguration of the Kartarpur corridor with the fall of the Berlin Wall, which united West Germany and East Germany, and it marked the beginning of the end of the Cold War. Now let's take up an article from page number 8. Environmental activists have questioned the feasibility of establishing a monkey park in Karnataka. See, the government of Karnataka has proposed to set up a monkey park in order to contain the problem of man-animal conflict. In the Shivamogga district of Karnataka, the menace of crop raiding and plantation raiding by monkeys has increased substantially because of severe habitat destruction. Over the last few years, sensitive habitats have been destroyed because of unauthorized construction activities and unregulated development activities. This destruction of habitat has promoted a change in the food pattern and the behavior pattern of the monkeys. Since their natural habitat has been significantly degraded, it has become extremely difficult for the monkeys to source their food. And this has pushed the wild monkeys closer to human habitation. So they find it easier to raid the nearby agricultural crops and plantation crops, and they have taken a particular liking for the areca nut plantation crops which are widely grown in the region. So these crop raids by the wild monkeys have destroyed the plantation crops in the region, and hence the farmers have incurred significant losses. So the farmers had been pressurizing the government of Karnataka to come up with a solution, and it has proposed to set up a monkey park in order to contain the wild primates and in order to deal with the problem of man-animal conflict. But environmental activists have questioned the feasibility of the project, and they have said that the Karnataka government should have conducted enough studies before taking up such ad hoc projects. Because according to them, if wild primates are contained in an artificial habitat, it could risk upsetting the natural ecology of the region, it could disrupt the food chain, and more importantly, it could spread a variety of infections amongst wild primates, such as the Kyasanur Forest Disease, or also known as monkey fever. See, the Kyasanur Forest Disease is a viral disease that can cause hemorrhagic fever. It is endemic to South India and it has been reported in Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. The vector or the carrier for the virus are ticks, and they are known to transmit the virus to small mammals through their bites. This disease can affect human beings as well if they are bitten by these ticks or if they come in contact with the infected mammals. See, this is the virus ecology for the disease. The virus is found in ticks. They are the carriers or the vectors. When they bite small mammals such as monkeys, rodents, etc., they will easily transmit the virus. These ticks can even transmit the virus to cattle as well. But the most affected are monkeys. So when human beings come in contact with these infected animals, even they will contract the virus. And especially forest-dwelling communities are more vulnerable because they could be bitten by these ticks when they go to collect forest produce, or they could come in contact with these small mammals. Once infected, the symptoms include high fever, frontal headaches, and this is followed by hemorrhagic conditions such as bleeding from the nasal cavity, bleeding from the throat and gums, and it can even cause internal bleeding such as gastrointestinal bleeding. The other symptoms include vomiting, muscle stiffness, tremors, absent reflexes, and mental disturbances. The disease can even turn fatal as well. But luckily, the disease can be prevented by a vaccine. The vaccine is made using an inactivated KFD virus that is laced with formalin or formaldehyde. And other preventive measures have to be taken, especially by forest-dwelling communities. They need to use protective clothing when they go to collect forest produce, and they should also take up measures to control the spread of ticks in the region. Next, we have an article on page number 9, which refers to the visit of the Indian Defence Minister Rajnath Singh to Russia. The article says that India and Russia are at an advanced stage of negotiating and finalizing the agreement on reciprocal logistical support. Such a logistics exchange agreement is mainly intended for the navies of two countries. By agreeing to provide for reciprocal logistical support, the two navies agree to open up their port facilities and provide for refueling and resupplies to the naval ships of the other country. India has already signed similar logistics exchange agreement with the United States, which is officially known as LEMOA, or the Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement. India has also signed similar agreements with France and South Korea. These agreements were signed very recently, and hence it can be very important for prelims. India is also holding advanced negotiations with countries such as Russia, Japan, and Australia. And these logistics exchange agreements are also expected to be finalized very soon. The main purpose of these agreements is to increase the operational reach of the Navy and to promote interoperability amongst friendly navies. Now let's take up an article from page number 9. The National Green Tribunal has given a final opportunity to the Environment Ministry to implement a ban on those RO filters which are currently wasting more than 80% of the water. See, RO filters are considered to be very efficient in water purification, and they make use of the principle of reverse osmosis. They use a membrane which is partially permeable, and by using this membrane and the principle of reverse osmosis, it removes ions, unwanted molecules, and large particles from the water that is being treated. Even though these RO filters are very efficient in treating water and in water purification, they are not exactly environment friendly. Because some of the RO filters are currently causing a very high wastage of water. Some of these RO filters are wasting more than 80% of the water that they are treating. Now let's say a RO system is being fed with 10 liters of water. In most of the RO filters that are currently available in the market, only 2 liters of water is being recovered for consumption. And the remaining 8 liters is being wasted and it is being drained out. So this high wastage of water being caused by few RO filters is not environment friendly. And hence, the National Green Tribunal had set up an expert committee to look into this issue. Based on the recommendations of this expert committee, the National Green Tribunal had banned the sale of RO filters which are wasting more than 80% of water in May 2019. It had directed the Ministry of Environment and Forest to issue an appropriate notification. But even after 6 months, the Environment Ministry has failed to issue the notification, and hence the NGT has issued a final warning and it has directed the Environment Ministry to issue the notification by the 31st of December. Based on these guidelines of the NGT, only those RO filters which are recovering more than 60% of the water are allowed to be sold in the market. In the future, it expects the Environment Ministry to lay down provisions to increase the recovery percentage to 75%. And the NGT has also said, whatever water is being wasted, it has to be used for non-drinking purposes, such as cleaning, gardening, etc., instead of being drained out. Now let's take up a column from page number 10. The column written by Biswajit Dar evaluates the defensive mindset of India during trade negotiations in the backdrop of India's decision to walk out of the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement. See, India decided to quit the RCEP in order to fulfill the demands of the farmers, the Indian industry, the trade unions, and the civil society organizations. All these stakeholders, including the Indian government, believed that the RCEP would have a negative impact on India's agriculture and our domestic manufacturing sector. See, even though India has championed the cause of liberalization and globalization, it continues to make use of tariffs in order to protect sensitive sectors such as agriculture and manufacturing. The Indian government has consistently made use of tariff protection because it knows very well that India's small and marginal farmers, they can never compete with the agri-businesses of developed and emerging economies. The Indian government knows very well that our manufacturing sector and our MSME sector can never compete with the manufacturing powerhouses such as China, South Korea, etc. So these structural weaknesses of the Indian economy and this lack of competitiveness amongst India's producers and manufacturers forces the Indian government to have a defensive mindset when it enters into any trade negotiation. That's the reason why India has insisted on excluding the agriculture sector at the WTO. That's the reason why India has kept out sensitive agricultural products from the FTAs that it has signed with the ASEAN, Japan, South Korea, etc. Because see, any FTA tries to promote import liberalization and it tries to eliminate tariff protection. But unfortunately, India has learnt a hard lesson with most of the FTAs that it has signed. With regard to the FTAs that we have signed with ASEAN, Japan and South Korea, India has learnt that the trade deficit has increased significantly and it has come at the cost of India's domestic sector. These lessons made India adopt a defensive strategy during the RCEP negotiations because India was never comfortable with the long-term objective of RCEP. Under RCEP, the other 15 countries had stated that their long-term objective is to completely eliminate tariff protection in the RCEP region and to promote 100% import liberalization in the RCEP area. It was this long-term objective of the RCEP which made India quit the negotiations. The Indian government is well aware of the weakness in its domestic sector. India knows very well that its domestic sugar industry would collapse if it allows cheaper imports from Australia, China, Thailand, and Indonesia. That's the reason why these countries have already filed a case against India at the World Trade Organization and they have challenged the fair and remunerative price subsidies that the Indian government provides to its domestic sugar industry. India is also aware of the weakness in its dairy sector. India knows very well that its small and marginal farmers would never be able to compete with the industrial scale production of dairy products which is seen in New Zealand and Australia. New Zealand is already the second largest exporter of dairy products in the world. So the industrial scale of agricultural production in these countries and their agri-business models will wipe out the subsistence form of farming which is practiced in India. India is also well aware of its weakness in the manufacturing sector. Especially manufacturing powerhouses such as China can flood the Indian market with their cheap manufactured goods and this can wipe out domestic manufacturing units. The Indian industry has already been extremely concerned about the increasing inflow of Chinese goods into the Indian market. See, in 2005, Chinese imports accounted for only $11 billion. But in 2018, Chinese imports have increased to $76 billion. So the Indian industry and the Indian government were well aware of the consequences of allowing greater market access to China under the RCEP. So that's one of the reasons why India decided to quit the RCEP negotiations. See, the decision taken by the Indian government is understandable because it has been taken to protect the country's domestic sector. But the writer raises a very important question. He questions whether this is the right mindset for an emerging economy to have. So the writer suggests that if India has to overcome this defensive mindset, then the only solution is to introduce long-lasting economic reforms which will promote the spirit of competitiveness. See, over the years, subsequent Indian governments have neglected the agriculture sector and the domestic manufacturing sector. That's the reason why they are not in a position to compete against foreign producers and manufacturers. It is this structural weakness of the Indian economy which forces the Indian government to adopt a defensive mindset during trade negotiations, and it forces the Indian government to rely upon tariff protection in order to protect its domestic sector. If India desires to come out of this defensive mindset, then the only solution is to introduce long-lasting economic reforms which will enable our domestic producers and manufacturers to compete against foreign vendors. Now let's take up another column from page number 10. The column written by R. Prasad evaluates the threat posed by vaccine hesitancy. See, vaccine hesitancy is nothing but the refusal or the reluctance to use vaccines even though they are available. This refusal or reluctance to use vaccines is based on superstitious beliefs, myths, misinformation and propaganda that has been deliberately spread against vaccines. Especially the poor and vulnerable communities and those who are gullible and naive, they tend to believe in such superstition and propaganda, and this has significantly increased vaccine hesitancy around the world. The writer refers to few such incidents where superstition and misinformation has been deliberately spread against vaccines. He refers to few incidents in UP and Kerala where a misinformation campaign was carried out amongst the Muslim community and innocents were made to believe that the composition of vaccines are haram or forbidden according to Islamic law, and this resulted in a significant reduction in vaccine uptake amongst the Muslim communities in these states. Then recently, spiritual leaders such as Sadhguru have made controversial and sweeping statements about the side effects of vaccines, and this will definitely have an impact on his numerous followers. And the emergence of social media has made it easier to circulate fake news and misinformation about vaccines, and this makes people gullible towards vaccine hesitancy. Then we have also had incidents wherein UN platforms have been misused to spread misinformation and propaganda against vaccines. Then we had a study in 1998 which had wrongfully claimed that MMR vaccine is causing autism. This conspiracy theory has stuck around and it is used even today to spread misinformation and propaganda against vaccines. So the writer concludes by saying that if such superstitious beliefs and misinformation campaigns are not challenged with accurate facts, then it is bound to increase vaccine hesitancy, and this poses a grave threat for the global vaccination program. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following statements are correct? The Kyasanur Forest Disease is caused by a virus belonging to the family Flaviviridae. The first statement is correct. This family of viruses also causes yellow fever and dengue fever. The second statement is also correct. The KFD virus is very similar to that of Alkurma hemorrhagic fever virus which is primarily found in North India. This statement is incorrect. Because see, the KFD virus is indeed very similar to that of Alkurma hemorrhagic fever virus. But this virus is not found in North India. It is endemic to Saudi Arabia. So the first two statements are correct. Option A is the right answer. Now let us take up the second question. Which of the following agencies are responsible for securing the Indian cyberspace? If you go through the options, we can say that CERTIN, NTRO and the National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center. All the three agencies are responsible for securing the Indian cyberspace. CERTIN has the overall responsibility to defend the Indian cyberspace against cyber attacks. NTRO is a technical intelligence wing under the research and analysis wing. NTRO is responsible for cybersecurity as well, because it is under the NTRO that we have the National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center, which is meant to protect India's critical information infrastructure. So option C is the correct answer. Now let us take up the third question. The landmark second judges case dealt with the collegium system of appointment of judges. Option B is the correct answer. Now let us take up a map-based question. The term Malnad or Malenadu refers to the western slopes of Western Ghats in Karnataka and as well as the eastern slopes of Western Ghats in Karnataka. Both 3 and 4 are correct. Option C is the right answer. Please look at the map. The entire stretch of Western Ghats in Karnataka is referred to as Malnad or Malenadu. Now let us take up a practice question from the 2019 prelims paper. Building Kalyana Mantapas was a notable feature in the temple construction in the kingdom of Vijayanagara. It was the Vijayanagara Empire which used to build Kalyana Mantapas as a part of temple construction. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, what do you understand by the term vaccine hesitancy? Suggest ways to overcome the challenge. The second question, India has always maintained a defensive mindset when it comes to trade negotiations. Evaluate the statement in the context of RCEP. So kindly write an answer to these questions and post them in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.